usually per stroke volume, and then by heart rate, you know, you increase from 80 to 100 to 150 to whatever. And giving your resting heart rate now of 5 liters, how much of the 5 liters, or how is the 5 liters are distributed in the body? Who is, if you like to open the windows, or is it okay for you? Anyway, so what do you think? If you have 5 liters to distribute, probably the majority goes to the CPU, right? The brain, which is about 1.5 liters. So 1/4 of what the heart pumps is actually just to kind of coordinate yourself. And then almost as much, like 1.2 liters goes through the kidney. But not because the kidney needs such a lot of oxygen demand. But why, what do you think? Because of clearance, right? If you want to get, whatever, to remove toxins, you have to have a low, a high volume load, otherwise, you know, the clearance is not very effective. So it's usually 1.2 liters per minute. And usually 1/10 of it is completely cleared of uremic toxins. So certainly that's not that 900 cc's, only the first 100 cc's are cleared and then the kidney shuts off for the next minute and then it starts again. It's on average, right? With one kind of, it's called the filtration fraction, is about 20%. Okay, so each, if you kind of fill into the kidney a fluid with a concentration of, for example, blood, urea, nitrogen of 100, your filtration fraction of 20%, it goes out at 80. Okay. But what's the circulation time of your blood? What do you think? How much does it take to go from the heart all the way to whatever, to the brain or to the door and back again? It's in the range of 30 seconds, roughly 35 seconds. Okay, so it's kind of spinning rather quickly, and so therefore it's enough if you remove 100 cc's from a liter, so that you have an excellent clearance for 24/7, okay? And so by saying that, I'm going to explain something that I don't like, but I have to explain it, because it's all driven by the Americans, because many people make a living out of it, because you have a continuous variable, as I said before, which is called the glomerular, the mouse. Called glomerular filtration rate, okay? And it's what I explained to you, how much is removed, or how much volume is removed from urine toxins. And since the normal level is 100, you could actually easily say, why don't we say it's percent kidney function? The normal value would be 100, everybody would understand. And if your grandmother would come to the clinic and you would say you have 15% remaining kidney function, like here, she would understand that it's kind of annoying to read. She would understand that that's not sufficient, right? And if you have a continuous parameter, like for example, where are you from? Vienna, that's not a good example. Who is not from Vienna? You are not.
Spain.
Ah, that's too far away. Who is from Austria but not from Vienna?
From
Graz. Graz is good. If you have somebody coming to you and say, you know, I want to go to Graz, is that either very far, a little far, medium far, not so far, very, you know, it's a continuous parameter. You could say it's 200 kilometers and everybody can judge on their own whether it's far or not far. Depends if you're whatever. If you're walking, it's probably considered far. If you go by train, it's not so bad. What I'm trying to say is, medical doctors like to have stages or categories, but it's stupid. You have a continuous parameter, and you would, you know, say between whatever from here to Semmering, it's not so far. It's the first stage, and then if you go from Semmering to whatever after Semmering. So it's much better to say it's percent kidney function, but again, there are people. This was actually done, the categories, they were actually driven because they thought that in heart failure, like if you have heart failure, it's also a continuous parameter, the pump function. And in the 80s and 90s, they classified it into heart failure rates. It was called NY, so New York heart failure rate 1, 2, 3, 4. And 4 was not very good, and 1 was kind of okay. So, you know, because nobody understood the ejection fraction. But here, I think it just doesn't make sense, but we have to live with it. And so there are 5 different categories, which is CKD, which stands for chronic kidney disease. And I should not complain because I'm on the borders of this KDIGO guidelines, but it's always, it's global guidelines, and the world is not very uniform, which is good, I think. But the Americans have a different approach than people from India, or Australia, or New Zealand, or China. So let's start. And again, normal is above 90, so the stage above 90 is normal, and usually you mean in the urine, and you will see that in a second. And if there is some albumin appearing in the urine, then you have either stage whatever, G1, A1, or G2, A2, or G, so you can combine this. One can occur without the others. You can have a normal excretory kidney function, so the removal of toxins is fine, but you can have also albumin leaking in the urine, for example, and vice versa. And so the obvious question is why are the thresholds or the cutoffs kind of given as 30 milligrams per day and 300 milligrams per day? Simply because if you're a healthy young person, you excrete less than 330. Okay? Eventually you can have 20, 25 if you exercise, or if you have a fever, or if you have a common cold disease, you can have a little bit of albumin, but not much. And the upper level of 300 is determined, it's the concentration where the dipstick gets positive. Okay? You pee into a beaker, the nurse puts down the dipstick and says it's positive for albumin or not. So there are two informations. One of it depends on the concentration. If you drink a lot of water, it remains negative sometimes. If you, whatever, if you're dehydrated or you don't drink anything, it gets, so it's kind of an average or just a ballpark number, so to speak. And the other thing, the dipstick only detects albumin. And why is that? Because it detects only anionic proteins. And albumin is negatively charged. So for example, if you suffer from other disease like a myeloma or leukemia, and if you excrete IgG, for example, in the or light chains in the urine, the dipstick will not detect it. Okay? Therefore, there were two guys, Mr. Jones and Benz. Benz Jones wrote urine, maybe you've heard about that. Actually, you know, you have to use other means to detect the protein in the urine by kind of heating and precipitating. But that's all you need to know. The normal range is 100, and then in 30 steps, like 90 to 60, 60 to 40, and this stage 3 is divided in 15 steps, 15, 15, 15, and 15. And usually you start renal replacement therapy, or you start developing kind of severe symptoms. If you have less than 10% or 10 milliliters per minute remaining kidney function, then you start getting short of breath because there's a lot of regulation that's not working, like the erythropoietin production, whoever is an endurance trained athlete here, they inject themselves with EPO to kind of increase their hemoglobin to be more performative. You will have fluid collection where it should not be, like in the lungs or between the myocardial and the pericardial. You will have swollen legs. You will feel miserable. You don't like to eat meat. Your urine is going to be foaming. A lot of things that you just. But usually it takes some weeks or years to develop all the stages, and below 10 you have to replace the kidney function. Okay. And 50 years ago, if you would have had kidney failure, or maybe 60 years ago, the doctor would say, "I'm really sorry, but you can't do very much." I mean, that's not true, because doctors never say that. They always say, "We have something," but in the end. And the dialysis became available in the late 60s, early 70s, but it was a very experimental procedure. Okay? And therefore, only very selected patients, very young patients, which were unfortunate enough, like who developed GN, which stands for glomerular nephritis, it's an autoimmune disease usually. And the incidence, as you see, or the prevalence remains the same over 50, 60 years. And at that time, you see that, for example, the yellowish area starts to increase, and the other one kind of remains the same, which is type 1 patients. So in red, it remains the same over time. And why is that? What's the prevalence of type 1? Diabetes. So if there would be now 15 or 2, 4, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so there are roughly 50 people in the room, how many of you will get type 2 diabetes in the next 60 years? So it's the first row. Okay, you 6, maybe not you. Okay. So it's roughly, I would say, in Austria it's about 6%, which is huge. In China it's almost 10% anymore. Okay, so 6 out of 60 will get type 2 diabetes. But type 1 is not that prevalent. It affects only 1 out of 1,000 or 3 out of 1,000, depending where you live. Okay, so it's that the ratio of type 2 to type 1 is almost 1 to 50. And nevertheless, you saw that initially in red, there were more patients with type 1 on dialysis compared to patients with type 2. Although they are 50 times more prevalent. So if this would, all of you would be type 2 patients, only you would be type 1. You would be exclusive. And you would have been selected for renal replacement therapy, the others would have died in the 70s. Why? Because they all died of macrovascular disease. They stroked out the type 2 patients. Or they had a myocardial infarction before they actually developed kidney disease. Okay, they have an overriding risk of macrovascular disease. And this, I was kind of mean to the medical doctors, like as profession in the world. On the other hand, there's not too much PR, which would have been actually necessary and helpful and justified, because the mortality rate in that time, if you had a myocardial infarction, was 50%. Okay? Every other one died, because there was nothing available. There was heparin, you know what heparin is? There was some kind of painkillers, morphine, which is not the treatment as we know. And that's it basically. And then there was some other things, but basically there was no treatment. You know, the treatment was bed rest. And if you had a bad day, you rested forever. And so, okay, nothing was good in the old days. And now, nowadays, what's the the mortality rate if you have a cardiac arrest, if you have the, not cardiac arrest, but a myocardial infarction, it's in the range of 5%. Okay, so it's 50 versus 5%. Every other one versus 1 out of 20. It's a tremendous improvement. You know, it's really something. Anyway, so this is the reason why type 2 patients are now getting more and more and more frequently admitted to be treated by dialysis, because previously they all died. And I'm not quite sure whether we should also tell some stories that you remember stuff. But since here in the late 90s, it was not completely clear whether the kidney disease in type 1 and type 2 patients was the same, because the type 2, they all died at the age of whatever, 50 or 60 before they actually developed kidney disease. Many researchers used different populations to study this phenomenon, because the indigenous populations, such as Aborigines in Australia, Native Americans in the US, Inuit in the north, they all have a very high likelihood or an elevated likelihood of getting kidney disease. And the question is, why is that? You know, they live there for millions of years, but they manage to reproduce themselves. So the average life expectancy of, for example, the Pima Indians, which is a tribe in Arizona, in Phoenix, is about 42 or 45. It's worse than Russia, which is unbelievable. And the prevalence rate of type 2 diabetes is, at the age of 30, it's almost 50%. Okay? And we could not talk, because they were studied and to find out what was going on. What was interesting is that each of our kidneys has about 1 million of small filters. They're called the glomeruli or the nephron. Okay? And the Pima Indians have only half as many, but also the Aborigines and the other indigenous populations. The filters are about twice the size as the Caucasian filters, which I found really traumatic, because if you remember, the factor 2 in biology is usually huge. Now imagine that your head is like twice as big as hers. Yeah, it would be, you know, everybody would look at you, I guess. Now, so why, you know, why this is, nobody knows, but the indigenous population have a very high rate of type 2. I think we will start with the cartoon. I said a kidney, which is shown here, has about 1 million of such glomeruli with the nephrons attached to it. The nephron is like the siphon from the sink, and there's a lot of reabsorption going on here. And if you have a cross-section through one of these glomerular loops, such as here, there is an inner space, so to speak, which is the primary, that's where the blood flows, basically, in red, and then yellow, they're called the endothelial cells, because they're on the inner side of the basement membrane, which is given red here. And then these Turkish guys are what's called the mesangial cells. Okay, and the mesangial cells serve the purpose to clean the filter, basically. They're like the vacuum cleaners, they kind of remove all the dirt from here. And then you have the basement membrane, and in kind of bluish, these are the food processes of the podocytes. And then this yellow one, it's where the primary urine or the primary filtrate is collected. And here the other guys are the parietal epithelial cells, or the Bowman, sitting at the Bowman cap. And this, oops. Now if you imagine, if you cut through here, the mouse is disappearing again. If you cut through here and you have a look, imagine you're sitting in the primary urine, okay, in the Bowman space, and you look at one of the capillaries, it would look like this. It's a very kind of beautiful and highly structured architecture that you see the podocytes or the visceral epithelial cells with their food processes, they are kind of intertwined in another, and you see the filtration slits here, one after the other. And you know, long time. Including myself, we kind of teach 20 years or 25 years the wrong story. Not really on purpose, but we didn't know better then. The general saying was that the slits between the endothelials, they're really wide. So they are not, you know, really affecting the filter function. But then through the basement membrane, and specifically between the podocytes, between the food processes, the slits have about a diameter of 50 angstrom. Angstrom is 10 to minus 10 meter. And the albumin has a diameter of about 26. So it should be easily, you know, being filtered from the inner of the capillary to the primary urine, and then would, you know, appear in the urine. But since I told you that we usually don't have urine albumin appearing in the urine, that can't be the explanation, because why is it protected from filtration? And the theory for a long time was that in the basement membrane, here in red, or indicated in black, the heparan sulfate side chains, they are negatively charged. And albumin is also anionic. It's also negatively charged. And therefore, the negative charges kind of, you know, prevent each other from being filtered. It was called the charge selectivity of the glomerulus. But wrong. Because an Italian postdoc in Karl Trückbarsen's lab in Karolinska spent like 4 years of his time for one paper, which was interesting, but I think he then quit research, because what he found is if he did a conditional knockout of the heparan sulfate side chains, so that the basement membrane no longer was anionic, okay, there was no negatively charged left at the basement membrane. And if you are holding to the mice in the green proteinuria, nothing. Okay, so the explanation of the charge selectivity was just wrong for many years, and many science papers have been published. Our GCI papers, that, you know, it's wrong. But what they found is that in the eye there was a issue with the conditional parts, but that's not the topic. But it was not, it's not so easy, because if you, and that's still an old slide from Doncic Kayashi's GCI paper, but I think it gives you the idea. If you cut through a glomerulus, which I showed you in the cartoon before, you see the capillary lumen, you see the endothelial cells, you see the basement membrane, and you see the food processes of this huge epithelial cells, okay? And if you magnify, like for example here, this area, you see these food processes, like an elephant foot standing on the basement membrane. And the basement membrane has three different layers. One is called the lamina interna, or LRI, lamina densa, which is just a description of the electron microscopic appearance, and lamina externa, which is the external layer. And here this SD refers to the slit diaphragm. And the interplay between one foot process and the other foot process, given in blue here, in the blue area, is actually a very complex phenotype, because you have a lot of spacing proteins or spacer proteins that connect between one food process and the other. Okay, it's like they talk to each other and see if they can. It's a dynamic process, it's not like fixed. And therefore, the first one actually that was discovered here, the first protein that was a kind of space and connection protein between the two proteases, was called nephrin. Because what Hortoff and colleagues from Finland discovered, that there were some very few families where they had a lot of miscarriages because they had an intrauterine defect, so that there was a heart drops of the unborn baby with a lot of edema. And it was called the congenital nephrotic syndrome of the Finnish type, because these embryos were lacking nephrin and therefore were leaking a lot of protein in utero and died before they could be delivered because of a generalized heart drops. And then certainly they found out that it was not only solely reserved to the north of Europe or Finland. There were also cases reported in the Arabic countries. But so, you know, this was how did the kind of field appear. Now, in terms of disease, just let me look what the other questions were that I... So, one will be about probably diabetes mellitus, and I think I'll hold it there. And about the glomerular structures, which I've seen here, you know, the mesangial cells, the endothelial cells, the glomerular basement membrane, the food processes of the podocytes, and the Bowman space, the part of the epithelial cells. So if, for example, they would just hypothetically, theoretically, a question that would say, what are glomerular structures in the kidney? You have multiple, it's actually two choices. So it's true or false. Is the podocyte a structure? Yes, right? Where's the podocyte? The podocytes are those cells that have these food processes, which you saw on the EM. These are the fat ones, like the pulpos. Okay, what, for example, are there parietal endothelial cells? Yes. Are there islet cells, islets of Langerhans? No. Yeah. No. Very good. So, because they are rare, where are they? Hangers. Whenever you look for a Christmas present, usually you, you know, give a book to your friend or so. Insulin and Langerhans. I would highly recommend the book by Michael Bliss. It's called The Discovery of Insulin, and it is everything in one, because you know, it all happened in Toronto in 1920, yes. The discovery of insulin, the story of Banting and Best, like the PhD student and a young surgeon without an employment, basically. He worked in a lab from a PI, his name was McLeod. He was never actually in the university, always traveling. And it sounds familiar to you. You never see your PI because they're always traveling. And then, you know, if somebody discovers that you made a great invention, all of a sudden step in and say, you know, we have done, we should, and I did. And that's what happened with them, right? McLeod all of a sudden said, you know, he, and then they had lawsuits and fought and decided not to speak to each other, shouted at each other, because the Nobel Prize was to. It was the shortest distance from an invention to a war, which was like 1.5 years. Because I think he got it in 1923. And Michael Bliss is a medical historian in Toronto, about 90 years now, but he went to the lab, covered all the stuff. And in 1920, it was not very easy to measure blood glucose. You know, nobody really knew what the pancreas was. and if the injected homogenates of the pancreas into other dogs, they died. And then if the kind of isolated insulin injected into dogs, the dog died again, because nobody really knew about hypoinsulinemia, hypoglycemia. It's a good story because it's like a thriller. It's about greed, it's about science, and about, you know, so I was just wondering whether the computer is connected to the internet at all. That's a book because it reads easily. And it costs maybe like 10 euros or so. The other thing is that it's, you know, it's a question about, how should I say that? If you have, usually in life, you have limited supplies, being it money, water, food, and you have bigger demand. And the question is who is getting it? And when they discovered insulin, the treatment of type 1 patients was starvation. Okay? To prevent the ketoacidotic coma and death, so they got an equivalent of one slice of bread every day. And for example, the daughter of the US Secretary of State at that time, a very wealthy and prominent man, developed type 1 patients at the age of 11, okay? Which was a catastrophe, but she had access to the best doctors, and the best doctors at that time, or the best doctor was Mr. Allen, Dr. Allen, and he invented the Allen starvation diet, which kind of worked because they survived for 2.5-3 years without ketoacidosis. But she wrote her memoirs, and when she was 14, she had 22 kilograms. Okay, and there's actually pictures in the book, seeing her, it's unbelievable. And then when her mother heard something about insulin and Toronto and Banting and Best, she demanded that her daughter gets the first shots. And she approached her husband, who was Secretary of State, and said, you know, call the dean at the university and we'll send our daughter there to get it. And he said, you know, we can't do that because there are also other patients in need. Why our daughter? And then she was really kind of furious and said she will divorce him and she, you know, he doesn't like the daughter, whatever, so eventually was never figured out who calls the dean. But in fact, the 11-year-old or 14-year-old girl came to Toronto, and actually the other patient was sitting in front of the lab at the lawn waiting for the next shots like IV drug abusers, right? You know, you have limited supply, and the question, you know, like, you can start from organ transportation, you know, it's a very good book. Cut out a very small piece of the kidney, which we do every day, and then we send it to pathology. And the pathologist says, I don't see anything. I mean, he doesn't say, I don't see anything, but he said, looks like a normal kidney. And then the trainee said, but the patient has a lot of proteinuria, it can't be a normal kidney. And the pathologist says, no, but see only minimal changes. And I mean, it's not how it happens because the pathologist knows, but if you don't see anything on light microscopy, you have to have electron microscopy to see the damage of the food processes. And therefore, it's called minimal change of brightness. And I think I'll skip that. That's how it looks like. The normal podocytes, and now you're an expert in the EMs. You see the food processes here, you see the body of the podocytes, and the food process here, cross-section, the basement membrane here. Here you see the endothelial cell. Here very nicely the podocyte. And if you have an effacement of this architecture, it looks like this, as everything is kind of damaged. Okay? So that's the classic case of the minimal change. What's the black dot in here? What do you think? What's in the capillaries? Black blood cells, no red blood cells. Okay? These are erythrocytes. Okay, what do you think to do? I think it's not necessary that you need to know that. I'll skip that. Maybe if somebody asks you about the classical diabetic kidney disease, it was first described by two pathologists in 1931. One's name was Kimmelstiel, I think it was Paul Kimmelstiel, and the other one was Wilson. So Wilson Kimmelstiel, his skull was called the nodular, because it looks like nodes, glomerulosclerosis. So there's parts of the glomerulus which looks normal, there are open filters, and there are some segments that are sclerosed. So it's called segmental glomerulosclerosis, Kimmelstiel-Wilson. And that's how it looks like in spot staining. So there are areas that appear normal, and there are segments which appear not normal. Okay, and I'll skip that. I think I'll... maybe I can show now bad science if you want to, because you're a good scientist. And there are papers like Nature, Medicine, Science Translation, or whatever. They all publish crap. Because, for example, there's the question is, if you have such a disease, that causes this normal architecture to look like that, and you develop end-stage kidney disease, is it, and usually this happens to young people, is it justified to do a kidney transplant? Because in like half of the cases, the underlying disease recurs immediately in the graft, because it's not the disease of the kidney itself, basically. It's more like an autoimmune phenomenon. You know, the immune system attacks the podocytes. Nobody knows why. And in half the cases, we have like an immediate recurrence of proteinuria. On day two after transplant, boom, the podocytes again damaged. So if you, for example, you know, if you have, there's a mother kidney, FSGS is on dialysis, I want to donate the kidney, it would be very helpful to have a predictive test and say, you know, you will have a recurrence, we don't do that, or you will have a very low chance of recurrence, and therefore a live donor transplantation is appropriate, right? I would want to know that. And this has been tried to answer with a biomarker study, because the guys from the US, from Stanford and other parts, said that the soluble urokinase receptor is a very good biomarker, because, for example, here, in the primary focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, and each node is an individual, you see those that recurred after transplantation at a twice as high serum level compared to the other, to the non-recurrent patients. I mean, first of all, the individual discrimination is not all that good, and everything is basically driven by two or three guys who are really high, but nevertheless, we found out that the SUPAR can nicely discriminate. Now then, and in fact, it could not be reproduced. And then if you look up SUPAR, you find it's predictive of schizophrenia and of, I don't know, whatsoever. So it's useless, but it has been published once. And the very same is true with another biomarker, which is a co-stimulation protein, which is on the antigen-presenting cells, so that you actually have a T-cell response. You have three signals. One is the T-cell receptor, the other one is the co-stimulation part, and then you have an auto-feedback loop of IL-2. And the very same authors published in the New England Journal that the B71 or CD80 in the podocytes are predictive of recurrence, and the group from Italy showed that actually it was an unspecific staining of the secondary antibody. Even with the New England, you can do that. Coming from the injury of the podocytes here, we're going now to injuries to antibody epitope complexes between the podocytes and the basement membrane. And the disease is called the membranous glomerulopathy, because it affects the membrane, where you see that the complexes are kind of baked in like chocolate in muffins or so. And that's one of the most common ones. And here the pathologist does not say, I don't see anything, or just see minimal lesions. That's the beginner's kind of choice, because you look at it and you see that actually the glomerular basement membrane here is much thicker than it should be, because compared to the basement membrane of the tubules, you see it's wider, there's no discussion. Usually the thickness is about 400 nanometers. Here we have like 600 or 800. And for those of you who have really good eyes, probably everybody, you eventually see that you have this, I'm too close to it. There's some kind of, some holes in the basement membrane, which is the non-stained immune complexes. So it looks like, I always forget what Zahnrad means in English. Zahnrad. I must have a small like insult or something. But whoever is connected, finds it out. So it's called the Zahnrad phenomenon, because here you see the silver staining. The immune complexes don't stain, and it looks like a and if you look at the electron microscopy, because in the silver stain it stains the collagen but not the immune complexes, you can see here this earwheel phenomenon. Maybe I'll remember this time. And in electron microscopy, you see the gear wheel phenomenon, because the black dots are the antigen antibody complexes, which are kind of not covered by the basement membrane. Okay? It's called the membranous nephropathy. Okay, and then I think I'll skip that. The next disease would be a disease of the basement membrane. It's kind of interesting because in the old textbooks, and all refers to like maybe 10 years before, or in science is now in the range of 2, 3, 4 years, and it used to be 20 years. Now if you stop learning after 4 years, you kind of know the half of what's actually true. It's called the, if you have an antibody against the collagen here, there are specific collagen components, there's collagen 1, 2, 3, 4, and there's side chains. And for some reason, if you produce antibodies against this, it's called the Goodpasture syndrome, or antibodies against the basement. And in the textbook, it used to say it's always young people, young male, who are working at the gas station, Tankwarte. Now, first of all, there is no Tankwart any longer, I guess, right? I'm not aware that I've seen one, with the exception behind the cashier, where somebody sitting there drinking beer and collecting money, but in fact, nobody's there to pump up your car. And they thought, because usually the same collagen is also in the lung basement membrane, and the disease starts with coughing blood, and kidney failure. And so it's called pulmorino syndrome, and the idea was, probably in the US, you know, 300 million found 2 or 3 young guys in the 70s as guests at the gas station with the disease. They thought that the detergents of the gas inhalation might expose, you know, the lung basement membrane to some toxins, and therefore some epitopes might appear, and then you have an immune response. It was just a story that somebody made up, and everybody repeated it in the next book, and it was always written, young guys from the gas station. In fact, it's still true that it's a disease of the younger population, so nobody really knows why. And it looks like this. If you do immunofluorescence, you see that along the basement membrane, you see the staining of the antibodies. Okay, and it's actually a very threatening disease, because before, I would say 15 years, 20 years, they all died of lung disease, of kind of respiratory failure and kidney disease. Now you can remove the antibodies with techniques like plasmapheresis or immunoinsertion. You remove the antibodies and you prevent the new production of antibodies, and therefore most of them actually can be saved or treated. So that's the one disease. And the other one is, if you have this collagen component missing, if you don't have this, then your basement membrane is getting kind of unstable. It's like a fence, you know, the fence that looks like this. And if you have, if the fence is not very good, it kind of gets thin and wider, and you start having proteinuria. It's called the outport syndrome. And the reason I'm telling you this is there are several reasons, because you're a researcher, or you become researchers, and they're very bright guys, and they're usually young, because once you are, I don't know, 35, you're no longer kind of curious enough to, you know. The thing is that there was the Alport syndrome, you have a mutation in the collagen gene, in the alpha 5 chain of the type 4 collagen, and it leads to a disruption of the basement membrane, and it's usually associated with leakage of blood, of albumin in the urine. And it's in 90% about its X chromosomal inherited. So if you have 2 X chromosomes, you are what? A dog or
a girl.
Right. So if you have 1 X chromosome with this defect, and the other allele is working, would you be sick or not?
No.
Almost correct. Because this hypothesis was called the Lyons hypothesis, suggesting that if you have 1 chromosome working fine and the other one is a defect, should not affect your protein production. Which somehow is true, because usually the women are the carrier, but were never really sick. But I have a couple of patients for some. So it's not, I think it's not true that this lion hypothesis that one is sufficient. It's probably sufficient to live kind of long enough in the older days where everybody died at 65. But nowadays, if you approach 90 or 95, it may not be kind of the case. And so again, the guys, as usual, they are the poor ones. They suffer because they have only one X chromosome. And they get kidney disease at the age of 30, usually, plus minus. And because the basement membrane is a defect. And because the basement membrane is also in the inner ear, they don't hear that good. So if you see a young guy with like two hearing aids in the renal clinic, you don't need to look at the chart. You see, you know, the Alport syndrome. And sometimes the sonular kind of in your eye, the sonular perpendicular are affected. So sometimes they don't see that good. But usually it's the hearing problem and the kidney disease. Okay, and just for you, I was telling you about the story about Dan MacArthur. Dan MacArthur is now about 32 or 33, and when he was about your age, maybe even younger, still an undergraduate, he went to Sydney, he's a geneticist now, to a kind of clinical genetics lab, where they tried to, or where they sequenced two siblings, young siblings at the age of 12, 13, or 14, with a muscle dystrophy. Yeah? Both bound to the wheelchair, and then sequenced the exons and found out that both had a full loss of function mutation, a homozygous mutation in the myosin gene. And again, myosin is necessary for your muscle activity. And they said, okay, we know what you have a mutation in your myosin genes, and therefore you're wheelchair bound if you have this muscle dystrophy. And then just for completeness, we also sequenced the whole exome sequencing of the parents who were apparently normal or not suffering from muscle dystrophy, and they had the very same full loss of function mutation. More than can be the reason for your muscle dystrophy, right? So, and then he went on and said, but you know, if you can live with a knockout of a very important protein that everybody describes, maybe that's not the only one. And there are some cohort studies like the 1000 genome project, where they did a deep sequencing of 200 participants and found on average that we kind of missing 10 to 20 proteins that your neighbor has, but you don't. Which is very interesting. It was a science paper 2 years ago, and it was adjacent by editorial. It's called the Human Knockout Project. Because the thing is, you know, why would we have a knockout of 10 genes or 10 full loss of function mutation of 10 proteins that you would have, but I don't, and you would miss 10 others that you would have. And some of them, or most of them, are intercellular. Some of them are in your olfactory region, so people speculate that smelling was very important in your phylogenesis, from worm to whatever man, but maybe no longer. So there are many different, but this is an immediate clinical application, because the guys at the company, they also did a PhD somewhere, and they're not stupid. They thought, you know, it's much easier to knock something out than to whatever continuously overexpress something. Because 2 years ago, three and a half years ago, a researcher from Houston, now it was Dallas actually, from Texas, her name is Helen Hobbs. She's a very strict person, and you're almost afraid, but she's very good. She looked at participants of a study. It's called the Dallas Heart Study. It's like 5,000 to 6,000 participants in Dallas. You know, the higher proportion of black patients, BMI of I don't know 35 plus, not very healthy lifestyle, high cardiovascular morbidity. And then she found very few, like of the 6,000, 6 or 7 of them, they had almost no cholesterol. Like the normal cholesterol is whatever, 200 milligrams per deciliter. They had like range. You repeated the measurement again, 6, and then they, you know, they asked them how they feel. Okay, same body mass index, same smokers, and same lifestyle. Virtually no atherosclerosis. It's very interesting. So did the CAT scan of the carotids and everything. And then they sequenced them and they found out that they had this full loss of function mutation, but in a receptor for the LDL, in a degradation protein. And so this, it's called now the PCSK9 inhibitors, because they, like the big companies, Amgen, saying if they can, you know, drink and eat and smoke whatever they want and have no atherosclerosis and no cholesterol, we rather kind of knock that out and sell that for, and that's for the next big thing. It's already like within 2 years and from IND on the market, and if you see the young and beautiful sales reps, they're selling this one, and the older ones, the grumpy ones, they sell the statins because, you know, nobody don't make any money with that. But that's actually just one example. And the other ones are, for example, they also found in this sequencing that if you have a full loss of function in one of the sodium channels in your nerves, you're insensitive to pain, which is very good because if you have a catastrophic, whatever, breast cancer, metastasis, you really have pain, or if you, you can give morphines, but then, you know, you're not, cognition is impaired, you have other many side effects, you kind of drop from the bed, get another fracture. And if you know, would be able just to knock out the pain but not influence your cognitive function, it would be great. And so it's the next big thing is, you know, the human knockout project, and see, you know, what full loss of function mutation is associated with which kind of phenotype. There are 2 or 3 examples. And again, the Alport syndrome so far has no benefit, but just out of them, just that you remember it. This is, you see on the left side, you see my skin under the, this is, says control, and that's the skin of a patient of mine long time ago who was coming from, I think, from UAE, from the Arabic Emirates, and he was like 18 or 20, he's been sent to Vienna to lose some weight because he was like also very horizontally challenged, so to speak. He was basically fat, but in the end we discovered that he actually had some proteinuria. And if you're very obese, you eventually can have a little bit. So the question is, shall we do a kidney biopsy? But in the end, you know, you could not, in the ultrasound, you saw somewhere something that looked like a kidney far away, so to speak. And so we thought we can't do the normal biopsy. And we, you know, we asked the radiologist to do it in a CAT scan, but in fact, he couldn't go into the CAT scan because he was big enough. And then I called my colleagues from the veterinarian university because they have this horse CAT scan, but at that time the horse CAT scan was under repair, so we were stuck and saying, you know, how can we diagnose him? And we thought, you know, if the collagen is a defect, why don't we do a little bit of a skin biopsy? I did a lot of skin, so we just did a lot of skin biopsy and did this staining for the different collagen components in the skin. And you can see in my skin, the alpha 2 chain of the type 4 collagen looks nice, like this one. That's the epidermis, that's a hair follicle here. And also the alpha 5 chain of the type 4 collagen, kind of is very, appears nicely here. In the patient of the Alport syndrome, the alpha 2 chain is fine. See the epidermis here, it's the outside, the hair follicle, but there's no alpha-5 staining, or there's no staining for the alpha-5 chain, which should be here. Here, that's it. Okay. So you could say it's skin biopsy sometimes helps, but it's just to illustrate that you have a if one has a defect in the basement membrane, you will have a kidney disease kind of very early soon. Right, and I told you that we have this full loss of function sometimes. Now this is the classical case where you have a loss of function patient, right? You don't express the collagen 5. Now those patients are getting kidney disease at the age of 30. I mean, they're getting terminal kidney disease. They need renal replacement therapy. Now if you put in the kidney from a deceased donor, it's very, 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 very has a normal alpha chain, alpha 4, 5 chain, right? And so in about 5 to 10% of the cases, those recipients make antibody against this alpha 5 because they've never seen that, because they have this full loss of function, and develop something like we discussed before, the good pasture syndrome, right? And so this is the proof of concept that if you include a new antigen, basically a new epitope that hasn't been seen before, but 1 out of 10 develop antibodies and you know, the kidney fails soon, but 90% don't. And the very interesting question is why is that? Right? You have the very same mutation, you're missing the alpha 5 chain, you get a kidney transplant that actually has the alpha 5 chain, you make antibodies, in 90% nothing happens, and in 10% they are actually active. So there's a lot of things to be discovered, but it's good that you know something. Now, I think I'll skip this one. Let's see what else we have. Okay. Let's see what else we need to know. We have the stuff we just discussed about L-port syndrome, the components of the basement membrane, the collagens. Maybe I should tell you a little bit about the polycystic kidney disease, which I will do now, and then I will entertain you for like 5 minutes on the complement, which is the next kind of also new thing in kidney disease, because mutations in the complement system are now becoming more and more clear and more better studied, and like the big companies making big bucks out of it, so you're rather know because it's something that's contemporary. Now again, polycystic kidney disease. Usually, you know, there's nothing wrong, or eventually 2 cysts in your kidney, if you are, whatever, 20, 25, 30, but polycystic kidney disease is the most prevalent, or most incident actually, inherited disease. So what do you think, what's the incidence per newborn? How many newborns actually suffer from polycystic kidney disease? You probably don't know, but it's about roughly 1 out of 800 newborns, 400 to 800. And so I was actually, I tend to forget it always, but I think I remember correctly that each year in Austria there are about 30,000 live births, I guess. And if the incidence is 1 out of 800, so you can actually, you know, divide, just for curiosity, you say it's 36,000 divided by 360 days. So there's about 1,000, correct, or 100. It must be 100 births every day. 1,000, huh? Right. So you have on average one, if the incidence is 1 out of 800, and you have 1,000 births every day in Europe, in Austria, so every day there's one poor child born with this inherited disease of polycystic kidney disease. And that's a very interesting story because, you know, initially thought you will, you have cysts in your kidney, then, you know, people found out that you also have cysts in your liver, that you eventually have in your cranium, in your blood vessels, you have aneurysms, like in your circulation, in your brain. Then people found out that you eventually have some kind of weird immune system failures. And in the end, you know, it turned out that this was one of the first genes that was cloned by a guy who was working when he left. He was a bright guy, Harris. He kind of, in the early 90s, when it was really kind of complicated with the sequencing changes, he kind of discovered the gene or the mutation. Then he thought, you know, that's so time-consuming and boring, it doesn't earn any money. He went to I think it was Goldman Sachs, to become an investment banker, and made a lot of channel that's defect. And the calcium channel is responsible for the cilia movement of like each cell, and that's also something that was not really known before. It's like if you swim, if you do a snorkeling, you see the seaweed that kind of checks the water and the current of the water, and so each cell obviously has some kind of like cilia, and the cilia kind of responds to the cells about what's outside. That's my naive explanation. And these pumps, if they are defect, kind of leads sooner or later to this phenotype of polycysts. So the kidneys are about the size of a basketball. So usually people cannot, you know, kind of eat enough, and can, you know, if they want to unleash their shoes, it's very hard for them. And so usually at the age of, I don't know, 30, 35, they have to undergo kidney transplantation, okay? But it's not only a disease of the kidney, it's a systemic disease, because the calcium channel, the defect, you know, affects a lot of things. So sometimes they have to undergo also liver transplantation. Sometimes it's necessary to remove this huge kidneys, because they're again the size of a basketball, and they appear very slim, but they like look like they were pregnant. So it's a prevalent disease. It's a disease of the cilia, of the calcium channel. It leads to end-stage kidney disease in early age, usually between 30, 40, maybe 45, and there's not really a treatment. I say there's no treatment because there's echoborins. Who knows about echoborins? Was the name Peter Agri sounds familiar to you? No. He won the Nobel Prize for the discovery of echoborins. But not for medicine, but for chemistry, because he's a chemist, I guess, in the late, early 90s, I guess. And he's a funny guy because he lived in the Midwest, and there is nothing, basically. And there's this Dennis restaurants. Have you ever been in the West? It says, you know, Dennis, you can eat breakfast and lunch and dinner. It tastes all the same, but it has open all day. And they have these huge advertising boards and say, you know, today is the whatever Super Bowl and whatever a college team plays against whatever. And if Peter Agri was awarded the Nobel Prize, you know, if there was only his own dinner, he used to go with his family. And they said, you know, congrats Peter for the Nobel Prize. And he was driving by with his small sons, and, you know, I was asking them and say, do you think I'm famous now? And the son said, well, Daddy, will you be at the Simpsons? And he said, probably not. And I said, then you're not famous. This was his definition of famous, and maybe they were right. But so the echo prince is a fascinating story, because if you think the cell membrane is a lipid bilayer, right? It's lipids. And how can water kind of go through a polarized membrane or an unpolarized membrane? If you wash your clothes, you have to add detergent to get kind of access to the dirt. And how water is actually going through these membranes, it's a very funny story. The echoborins, in the meantime, they're everywhere. They are, I don't know, 12, 15 different water channels. But in the kidney, they're very important, because they have to kind of reshuffle or withhold or retrieve about 180 liters of filtered water every day. You know, 180 liters is a lot, so to speak. And if this would not work, you would have something that's called diabetes insipidus. You will lose like 10, 15, 20 liters of water every day, which you have to drink. And the reason I'm telling you is because companies had these echoborins or the echoborins so that the water is not reabsorbed for a very rare disease, which is called syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, which you just forget, and nobody needs that, right? And so they thought, you know, we have the patent, blah, blah, blah. And now they tried to target the polycystic kidney disease, I would say, community. And they had like two New England papers showing that if you take that for 3 years, you lose 1% less kidney function than the other group with placebo. And we're talking about 1%, okay? At the side effect that you have to drink like 6 liters of water every day, because you pee a lot, you have to get up in the night, and you have to. Very few patients that don't want to go into detail, so you know, my recommendation to the EMEA was, you know, not to, to use that. And also, I really like the British, because they're very bright and usually independent from companies. And the body there, it's called NICE, for National Institute for Guidelines, whatever, evaluation. And initially they recommended that this drug, this echoborin drug, should not be authorized and you know, approved. And then the company basically went to the patients group, because if you have an inherited disease and you know that your son actually carries the gene and you know what's going to happen at the age of 30, and it's kind of an unpleasant situation if there's nothing to do, right? It's like if you have, I don't know, a high prevalence or a history of inherited, I don't know, dementia. If you know, at the age of 50 you will be demented and there's nothing to do. You can read books or you can calculate the whole night, it won't change the outcome. Then you are happy if somebody offers you something. And they actually then went to the patients group and supported them and so on. The patient said, the doctors cannot withhold them therapy, although if it's not great in kind of action, they demand to have that. And so NICE actually changed their recommendation, say if the patient wants that, we can prescribe that. Which I found very, how should I say, I didn't really like the idea, that the companies, say, we have something, we go to the patient and tell them to, So anyway, so polycystic kidney disease, I think we have heard about the prevalence, the most prevalent disease, early dialysis at the age of 30, 40, 50, no therapy available because inherited. The defect is a calcium channel that affects not only the kidney, but also the liver and other organs. It's a very polymorphic mutation because the gene is very very large and it's not always the same mutation. So therefore the phenotype can change a little bit from a lot of big cells to many smaller ones, but in the end the phenotype is pretty straight. There's also what's called autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease type 2, which is a genetically different disease, and very rarely develops end-stage kidney disease before the age of whatever, 80 or 85, so it's very unusual. Okay, but these are the ratio of type 1, so autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, or let me call it ADPK1 to 2 is about 91, or so only 10% of type 2, but they are not those with the clinical problematic outcomes. So this was cystic kidney disease, and the very last one, maybe, is HUS. Change my presentation to another one where the complement system is easier to understand. There's some disease, specifically kidney disease, that were kind of unknown in origin. They were labeled, they were described as they appeared for the pathologist. For example, on the right hand side, the triple D is not the terms for epidemiology, because what was the definition for epidemiology?
Determinants
and distribution of disease. It's not. Here we speak about the three D's, because it's a description of a kidney disease. It's called dense deposit disease, or deposition of electron dense deposit in the kidney in the biopsy. Okay, I think I'll have looks like this one. Okay, you see, by now you're an expert pathologist. You see that it's the basement membrane here. That's the capillary loop inside, and you see this black kind of depots along the basement membrane. And the trick is, if you do a transplant, they come back immediately. So it's like if you have hair loss, inherited hair loss, you change the sieve of your sink, and the next day, the next sink is clogged. Because it's not the sieve's problem, it's the hair loss that causes these depositions. Okay? So it's not surprising if you do a transplant, it comes back immediately. It's not really known, or it was not known by... Actually, I had a patient, he unfortunately died a couple of months ago. He was from Salzburg, and he received like 5 kidney transplants, and they lasted for like between 2 weeks and 2 months, and nobody really knew why, because he was transplanted when he was, I don't know, 13 or 14, you know, people said he was not taking the immunosuppression or this and that. And in the end, he had one of the rare diseases, which is now called dense deposit disease. And dense deposit disease basically has been shown to have mutations in the complement cascade, which leads to there are different factors. One is factor H, factor 1, membrane cofactor protein, whatsoever. There's what's called the 3-3 nephritic factor, and also the it's called C3 nephropathy, suggesting that what has been found, that if you have a mutation in the complement factor 3 gene, you will have an upregulation and a continuously activation of the immune system. Nobody really knows why it kicks in suddenly, because you're born with it and you live for that with it between, you know, 15, 20, 25 years, and all of a sudden nobody really knows why. You have an exacerbation of your complement system and leading to like an autonomous storm of cytokines and kidney failure. And this is called C3 nephropathy or membrane proliferative, but I think it's for you it's too specific. Maybe it's the story is good because in England, or I did not know that before, that a lot of people from the Greek side in Cyprus live in London, and I think it's in the, forgot, in the south or east of London. There's a community there, and the nephrologist actually found that in his dialysis unit, they're based on the population he serves, a lot of people from Cyprus, younger people. And he said, how many dialysis units are in Cyprus? And they're only like from 3 or 4 or 5. And so we basically went there and collected some samples and sequenced most of them, and they found out that they had a very common mutation. And there's some small islands, the degree of inheritance is rather high. So we found that most of them had a mutation in the C3 complement factor 3 gene, leading to kidney failure. So I think that's basically all you need. I don't want to be too specific about other things. And I think I'll stop you if you have eventually questions, comments, stuff. I will let me double check my last question. System and innate immunity system, if you block that, you will die of an opportunistic infection, probably. But that's not the case, unlikely. So fortunately, there's nothing, basically. Only in a serogon, only meningococci, kind of for some reason, a higher danger, but other than that, there's not really a high incidence of infection. Now, the company that produces these complement blockers, they were initially indicated, or the file for IND was for a disease that's called paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, which is also a genetic disease. But now they're making a lot of money because the treatment per patient costs roughly 500,000 euros. So my budget for my department, just for medication, is roughly 11 million euros. And I take care of 10 patients with HUS. And 10 patients make up half of the budget. Right? 10 patients by 500,000 is 5 million. And since the patent runs until 2019 or so, 2019, there's another like 2.5 years where they can cash in. There's this what's called the orphan drug law, that if as a company, you know, you kind of target a very rare disease, the argument was, but we will never get reimbursed for our efforts, so therefore we can basically ask a fantasy price because it affects only a few patients, which is true. But in the end, you know, if you're taking care of that, it's always the same. If you speak with the administration or the controlling and say, how many patients do you have? Why do you need to treat them? And again, it comes back to what I said initially about limited supply and demand, like in insulin. We have a healthcare budget. The question is, you know, those poor guys, we can say, well, you have a very expensive disease of like 500,000 euros. I could cure 15 patients with heart disease. You know, there's not such a trade-off. But even if you know, if you would pay 100% of income for healthcare, there's actually a research for that. It's called cost-effectiveness analysis, or in American terms, how much bang for the buck. So how to spend the money that you get biggest kind of fireworks. But in the end, you know, it doesn't work that way, because if you have a very prevalent disease, you know, I said, I don't know, you have prostate disease, okay, because everybody says, well, prostate disease is a cheap disease, but it's a prevalent disease. And if you have a very rare disease, it's HUS, it's maybe equally expensive, but you know, it's nobody to blame for it. So I think it was a little bit entertaining, although it was late for you and kind of me, and we kind of discussed most of the questions.